There are times when I want to play the NES, but have no idea which game to play. When that happens, I usually turn to a higher power.
Rob, thou art my master. Command me! Yes, yes, the black box games, of course! Yes? Yes? Really, that one too?
The Black Box games were 30 titles published by Nintendo of America between 1985 and 1987. They were broken up into 7 different series: Action, Sports, Arcade, Education, Programmable, Rob, and Light Gun. And, oh yeah, they were released in funky, fresh black boxes that looked pretty cool back then, and they're pretty cool now as well. Due to this special occasion, I'm breaking out the old toaster oven NES. First up is Wrecking Crew, which is part of the Programmable series. The object of Wrecking Crew is to go through the level and destroy all the bricks, doors, windows, stairs, etc. while avoiding all the enemies. If you smash everything up, you clear the round. As you can probably see, if you're not blind, that's actually Mario you're controlling. But he's not a plumber, he's actually a construction worker here. And no, I will not make a Village People reference. Okay, fine, just this once. The enemies are a little strange. You have this giant crotch crab thing, as well as these eggplants in hazmat suits. Yeah, that's not trippy at all. Even if the game can appear tedious, the level design at least keeps it a little interesting, and you have to use your noggin a little bit as you go along. What makes Wrecking Crew programmable, you may or may not ask? Well, you can design your own levels and save them, and then try them out. And here, oh god, yeah, I'm running away. And dead. So is Wrecking Crew bad or good? I think it's in between. It's your call on this one. Popeye, part of the arcade series and redundantly based upon the arcade classic. The object of Popeye is to have him collect all the hearts, musical notes, and letters that spell help me that are dropped from olive oil. All the while avoiding Brutus. If he gets too close, you can always grab that old can of spinach and whoop some fatty boy ass. Come here, come here. Besides the spinach, there's the old bucket trick. Watch this, watch this. Yeah! Look, I'm going to hit little Sweet Pea for bonus points. The first couple levels are pretty easy, but the third is a little more harrowing. Not only do you have to avoid Brutus, but also this bird that comes after you. Yeah, see right in my eye. It may be simple, but Popeye definitely is a classic, as I said before, and it's solid. Baseball, the original. Probably the worst. Why is baseball so bad? Look at the team selection. ACDPRY? I'm not even sure what that's supposed to mean. Take a look at the player stats. That's right, you won't see any here, because all the players are exactly the same. They hit the same, they run the same speed, they field the same. The batting isn't that horrible. Look how slow the batters run. It's disconcerting. But why this game really stinks is the fielding aspect. When the ball is hit anywhere, you do not control your fielder at all. The closest fielder is automatically run towards the ball. Nice play, Ozzie Smith. The only control you have is what base to throw it to. Look at the throws. They're all perfect line drives, even from the outfield. No realism at all. There's one extra bonus in the game. The manual states, and I quote, "Occasionally, fielders may temporarily disappear from the screen. This is not a malfunction." I guess we should consider temporarily losing a fielder, just adding to the challenge from time to time. Duck Hunt, part of the Light Gun series, and if you never heard of it, you don't deserve to be watching this right now. So what do you do in Duck Hunt? Well, you hunt ducks.
Now seriously, is there anything you can say about Duck Hunt that has not been said before? It's just an excellent Light Gun game. It was the first one released for Nintendo, along with Gyromite on the original system. And it's just a great game, it's fun, except for that stupid dog.
He may seem innocent, but this mutt has become one of the most notoriously annoying and evil characters in video game history. Shut up. Stop humiliating me! Die. Whee! Stack Up, or Robot Block. Why is the title screen different than the actual name? Anyway, this is one of the two games in the Rob series. Now, I'm not going to sit here and pretend I actually set up Rob to play Stack Up for a couple of reasons. One, Rob is hard as hell to set up correctly to get to work. And two, I'm missing the five colored Stack Up blocks. How do you actually play Stack Up? Well, your guess is as good as mine, but as far as I can tell, you control Professor Hector there, and you have to make five in a row, either vertically or horizontally. If you get five in a row, you'll hear the earliest example of voice sampling in Nintendo's history.
Ah.
Ooh. Yee. So Stack Up, yeah. Uh-huh. Donkey Kong, the 1981 classic that put Nintendo on the map in America. A revolutionary game for a few reasons. It was one of the first games to have multiple screens. It was also one of the first games to have a character-driven narrative. Donkey Kong actually used its characters to tell a story. Of course, today it's common, but back then it was very fresh and original. Deceptively simple, Donkey Kong is recognized as one of the harder, if not the hardest, of the classic arcade games. Being successful requires razor-sharp reflexes as well as great timing. You can get into the game and start playing easily, but if you actually want to be good, this requires lots of practice. And of course, you recognize the hero here. That's Mario, originally named Jumpman, and he has to rescue his girlfriend Pauline from the evil clutches of Donkey Kong, who actually in the story is his ex-pet. Probably not a good idea to have an 800-pound gorilla as a pet, but hey, what do I know? I'm just an idiot online reviewer. This guy starred in dozens of games. Other than the fact that the Nintendo version does not include one of the arcade levels, this is a very faithful arcade port. Whee! Clue Land, part of the action series, and we're gonna see in a second, it's not that action-y. You play as a red fish, yeah, that's what that's supposed to be, believe it or not. The object of the game is to collect all the gold coins on each level, which end up forming a pattern. If they look familiar, yes, they're the same exact model used for Link's rupees in Zelda.
Besides the trippy concept, Clue Clue Land is actually not an awful game, it's just kind of strange.
The gameplay is a little fun, yet challenging. The way you move is stick out your fish claw and grab onto the pegs. You pivot and rotate around them until you let go. There's no other game on the NES quite like this, that's for sure. But you'll either fall in love with this game or hate it. Aw, a smiley face. Oh, come on, that's no fish. It looks like a retarded sunburnt Pac-Man. Alright, Mach Rider, another programmable game. Well, that's pretty generic. You can select from two different courses, A or B, which gives a nice variety and some replay value.
Oh, I am Mock Rider.
As the Mock Rider, who happens to be dressed in a football helmet and shoulder guards, the object is to make it to the end of the course without losing all your energy. You do that by crashing and by getting smashed by these hybrid-looking dune buggies. The gameplay's a little uneven. You control your Mock Rider alright. You shoot, you steer, you shift between four gears. You have to avoid the puddles, oil slicks, and enemies, either by shooting them or going around them. Now, you have a rear-view mirror to let you know when enemies are approaching, but even so, it's very hard to avoid them hitting you from behind. Whoa, look at that explosion. Alright, design option. Here we can create our own course. Okay, we'll do a little twisty goo-type turn here. Alright, I'm just gonna... Okay, that's a weird spot for that. I shouldn't have put that there. Okay, I'm obviously horrible at this. Yeah... Golf, the only title in the Barely Qualifies as a Sport series. There's not a whole lot going on here. You have your standard 18-hole course, you select your club, direction of the shot, and then you swing away. And yes, that's Mario looking a little overweight. Apparently there must be an off-season in the Mushroom Kingdom. Now, I'm not a golf expert, so it would have been helpful if the game provided you with some sort of hint of what club to use in each situation, or at least how far you could theoretically hit with each club. But no, that doesn't happen here. The putting in this game is very strange. You have arrows that mark the slide of the hill on the green, but it's very difficult to know how hard to actually putt the ball. Using even a minimal bit of effort sometimes sends the ball flying on the putting green. Look at this. There's no music at all in this game, and there's not much in the way of sound effects. If you're terrible at this game like I am, most of the time you'll only hear sounds when you drive the ball into the bunker, out of bounds, or the water. You can almost hear that sound telling you, please shut this game off and stop playing. Did you know that the game of golf originated back in Scotland in the 1100s? And did you also know that golf, backwards, is flog? Come on, give me a break. I'm just trying to keep this even a little bit interesting. Ice Climber, part of the Action series. Like other Black Box games, you can select your starting level. Pretty cool option. So it's Ice Climber, and you're an Eskimo with a giant mallet, and you're not really climbing ice as much as you are smashing colored blocks and then jumping on top of them. The enemies are PETA's worst nightmare. You have exotic birds, as well as little baby seals that you smash over the head. Give me that skin. Your character jumps very high, but barely to one side, so you really have to be very accurate with the jumps. Your jumps have to be really on target. You'll even fall through sides of platforms that you think you've successfully landed on. Now, for some reason, there are eggplants you get for bonus points. Between this, the eggplants in Wrecking Crew, and the eggplant wizard in Kid Icarus, obviously someone had a fetish. And for some reason, I have to jump and grab the Ice Pterodactyl. Ice Climber is one of those games everyone has heard of, but it isn't on anyone's top 10 list for a reason. It's a fun but forgettable diversion.
Time for Excitebike! I don't know about you guys, but I'm sure excited! Oh, kill me.
Long before the X Games, and when the only person you knew who owned a dirt bike was your neighborhood's juvenile delinquent, there was Excitebike. Excitebike is a nice motocross game that's pretty challenging. What makes Excitebike so cool? You can pop wheelies, you can crash, you can take your opponents out, and you gotta beat the time. It's fun. There are five different tracks in Excitebike, which gives you a little bit of variety. Not a fan of the snot green color of the course, but that's okay. You can rev your engine to go faster, but if your temperature overheats, you're gonna have to pause for a few seconds while it cools down. The tracks are actually challenging, especially when all of the stupid other riders get in your way. Excitebike is actually part of the Programmable series and not the Sports series, and that's because you can design and save your own course. But the problem with creating your own tracks is that if you save them, they're gone once you shut off the system because Excitebike does not have a battery backup. I have to admit, I'm pretty good at designing these, so let's give it a whirl. Okay, here we go, and... Just have to warm up a little bit. Although it appears simple, Excitebike stands out uniquely as an original classic.
Woohoo!
Pinball for the NES displayed in nice pink bubblegum letters. The one good thing about pinball is that it's actually a two-tiered play field with an upper and lower area. You can hit the ball up and down between them, which adds at least a little bit of variety. It's a pretty dull experience for a couple of reasons. The colors are beyond drab. You have ugly blues, ugly pinks, and ugly yellows, and the layout isn't the most imaginative. In particular, the three bumpers on the bottom playfield are very annoying, since not many balls you hit will actually get through and actually go anywhere. They'll just bounce around and back. Look here. Ball hits the bumpers, bounces around, gone. Yes, there's penguins. Yes, there's seals. Yes, there's chicks. But where's the fun? The only thing interesting about pinball is the bonus stage, which you access by hitting the top right hole in the bottom playfield. Here, you control Mario and score points to rescue Pauline, who drops from above. This is especially noteworthy because this is the first time Mario appears in a game that has nothing to do with him. But wait, that's not Pauline. Pauline has blonde hair. That's a brunette. Mario can't be a man whore, can he? Ten-yard fight, the first football game on the NES. First, you select your level. You have a bunch here. We're gonna go with college. Here's a little bit of inaccuracy. There's supposed to be 11 players on the field for each team, not 9. On the field, you really only have 2 plays. You could either pass it to your running back, or throw it straight up. Or, as a combo, pass it to your running back, then throw it straight up on a flea flicker. The computer's defense is decent enough, even though you can trick them pretty easily. One of the annoying things is the time it takes for your man to move across your line of scrimmage when he's in motion. Alright, almost there. Almost there. Playing defense is a little strange in 10-yard fight. On the bright side, they give you a choice between 2 defenders. Then again, they only give you a choice between 2 defenders. Unlike baseball, 10-yard fight is actually playable, and it's much closer to the actual sports experience. Whoa! That guy just slid out of the screen! Let's see that one more time on instant replay! Donkey Kong Jr. Math, the sole title in the education series, thankfully. So what do you do in Donkey Kong Jr. Math? Well, the idea is to use your basic arithmetic skills to end up getting the total that Donkey Kong holds in the middle of the screen. You do that by jumping around and climbing the vines to select the proper numbers and the arithmetic sign that you want. It's as exciting as it sounds.
Donkey Kong Jr. Math is just a bad game, both conceptually and gameplay-wise. It's hard to put together the numbers you need for your answer, and just a bad idea. I mean, kids at that time didn't really want to play Donkey Kong Jr. Math.
Donkey Kong Jr., what were you thinking? Super Mario Brothers. I'm not too familiar with this one. It's a sequel to Mario Brothers, and also the top-selling video game of all time. Although not the first, Super Mario Brothers helped put the side-scrolling platform genre on the map. And I can still hit that one up every time. An epic game with great power-ups, great enemies, and the first Nintendo game to have an outstanding soundtrack. Goombas, Koopa Troopas, Bullet Bill, good old Beetle Bailey, Plants That Bite Your Ass. This game had it all. This game not only helped Nintendo dominate the video game world for the next 15 years, it helped save the US home video game market. Wait, what? Ichiban! Ah, that's better.
So that's the end for part 1. Part 2 is going to be coming soon, and I hope you're on the lookout for it. And I hope you're having almost as much fun watching this as I am doing it, or something.